So some of the concepts you saw in the last section, last lecture, will be a little bit repetitive. And then I will introduce OpenAI Gym Environment, which provides you the standard environments for testing and creating your reinforcement learning agents, and how to install that, and how to do a simple create simple algorithms using those environments. So here's the agenda. We will start with quick overview, and then we will go on and set up the OpenAI Gym environment and its dependencies. So it is Python based, so Python 3.5 or 3 onwards, and NumPy and matplotlib dependencies. So, and then we will see some environments offered by OpenAI Gym, such as Cardpool, Frozen Lake, and we will do simple algorithms along with that. And at the end, I will show you a demo of a Pong Atari game using deep Q learning. So it is already pre-trained model. So we'll just see it, how it is, you know, working. Okay, so to start with it, what is reinforcement learning? It is agent-based learning, and where agent interacts with its with the environment, and it gets feedback as a reward. And what basically agent tries to do is maximize this reward, accumulated reward over the period of time. So how it is different than other types of learning, like supervised and unsupervised learning. In supervised learning, we have labeled data, and we try to predict or train on one of the target variables. In unsupervised learning, we don't have labeled data, but we try to find the structures in the data. But compared to this, this is different than in two ways. Basically, it is an agent try to learn the environment with a reward it is getting, and what it can do is take the actions. And because of that, we have to start with some trial and error to learn our environment, and then agent gets better with accumulated knowledge of the environment. And because agent gets the reward when it takes the action, so it is kind of a delayed reward. So these are the two distinguishable features of reinforcement learning as compared to other types of learning. So you have seen this diagram in the last section. So there is an environment and there is an agent. Agent will take an action at any point of time t on the environment, and what it gets is the new state and the reward signal. So depending upon this information about the environment, the reward and the new state, agent will decide what will be the next action. So that's why it is called as agent-based learning. Okay, so now what we will do is we'll get a bit of a feel how this environment and you know, agent. And so now let's assume you are a reinforcement learner, and we have some environment, and what action you can take is action 1 or action 2, and there are two states possible. Two states are possible, state A and state B. So now you will tell me what action you are going to take, and let's see what rewards we get. Okay, so you can just, some of you can just shout out what action you want to take. So you don't know anything about the environment right now. This is the first t equal to 1 start state. So 1 or 2?
1.
Okay, let's try 1. Okay, you get plus 9. Now what? 1, okay, plus 8, okay, 1 again, okay, now what? Okay, see, again, pause. The reward you get depends on the state you are in and action you are taking, okay? Okay, 2, Yeah, exactly. But you exactly.
People are seeing the immediate
results. Yes, exactly. So then what do you need to do? So with action one, exactly, what different? One, you have tried, what now? Two? Yeah. Okay. Minus 13. Okay, now? One? Okay, see, the state is changed, okay?
How do you define the reward?
So that is some distribution. So that you don't know, that's the whole point. So as an agent, you don't know how the rewards are going to be. Okay? Come on. Two? Okay? Now? Okay? One? Okay. Okay, now? Yes, so now, one, so you need to kind of remember what you did previously, right? You have got a large reward, how you have arrived at the large reward? Yeah, okay, now, yeah, now, oh. Yeah. Yeah, okay, so I think now you kind of got it, right? If you just keep on doing one, what you get is reward around between 5 to 10. And if you do two, you get a negative reward, but the state is now different, and state B. And now from state B, if you take an action one, you get a large reward. So in state A, action one, and in state B, action 2 is kind of a optimal policy, what we are trying to get it at, right? Because if you just combine 37 minus 10, it's still better than just keep doing 1, 1, 1, right? Okay, so when we started, we didn't know what actions to take. So we take the random actions, right? So that is called exploration. So you have to explore your action place space. And what reward you're getting. So that's the environment I have defined. It can be multiple states in different environments. So it's the same. No, so the total, the state space is to A or B. So if you are in A, if you take action one, you get to go to state B. That's what the environment is. So, where is that? Okay, so when you explore it, when you choose randomly, that's what called as exploration. You are exploring the environment. And once you know that in state B, if you choose one, you get a large reward and you kind of remembered it, right? So, and you choose it again and again the later time, that is what call it the exploitation of the environment, because you are exploiting your knowledge about the environment. And there is always, yeah. No, no, it's nothing right or wrong. It's just, yeah, I mean, that's not what you want, right? When you get a negative reward, your total accumulated cumulative reward goes down, right? So, no, it's not about right or wrong. It's just the less reward you are getting in that state, you are taking that action. Hmm? Yeah, so that's what we figured it out. Right? Optimal policy is in this state, this is the action in this state, B state, action is 2. In some different setting, different kind of a distribution of the rewards, taking action one in A and again B, action taking B in even in state B can be a optimal value. Now about rewards, so it is what the environment is defined. No, right now this is a simple one, so it's just a tabular way of defining the rewards. No, A is 2, because that's how you the state is changed, right? A to B. So in B, if you want to take one and get the high reward, you have to be in the state B, right? From A, how you will go to the state B? Yeah. So if you keep on doing one in state A, you will end up in having reward between 5 and 10, which is average kind of reward. Yeah, cumulative reward is more in this policy. Okay, so maybe I can answer the questions as you go. Let's move ahead. So this demo was inspired by the demo given by Dr. Richard Sutton in one of his lectures. So he used the Lisp programming. I just tried to mimic it in the Python. Okay, so we'll quickly go over some of the basic concepts in the reinforcement learning, and then we will jump to the OpenAI and its installation and implementation. So policy is the way the learning agent behaves at a given time and in a given situation, and it's basically it's mapping between the state and the action. So what states are there and what actions you will take. A reward signal is what the it's a scalar number returned by an environment, and that's what how agent learns or agent knows that whatever action is taken, how good or bad it is. So as I said, the goal is to maximize the accumulated reward over the period of time. So value function is associated with action, how good that action is, and how good that action is going to give me the total accumulated reward. Model is basically a descriptor of environment, how environment is working, and with model, agent can basically infer how environment is going to behave in different actions and different states. Okay, so now what we saw in the demo or the little interactive demo, there was an environment, some environment which you didn't know how it is going to behave in terms of rewards and actions, and there was a problem, reinforcement learning problem, where we want to maximize the total accumulated reward. Now if you want to design some algorithms or test some algorithms, environment plays important role. Say suppose you design one algorithm and you test it with, say, customized environment you build yourself, and some other guy build another algorithm, it's very difficult to compare or test those two algorithms if the environments are different. So to solve this problem, OpenAI, what they did is they took the different environments from the literature, and they created this library where the standardized environments you can use for training and designing your agents. The advantage being, you can compare these two agents or the two algorithms because the environment is standardized. And so what is OpenAI Gym? It's a toolkit for developing and comparing reinforcement learning algorithms. Why you can compare? Because the environments are standardized, and that's why you can compare two algorithms developed by two different people on the same environment. The library Gym is nothing but a collection of environments, and we will see what are different types and what are different environments in this library. So this is the URL. And we'll go to that URL and see the different environments. But what problems it tries to solve is it gives you a better benchmark, and it standardizes the environment. And because of this, there are many advancements possible where people come and develop their environments against this standardized, develop their algorithms against this standardized environments. So this is the, let me go to, is it visible at the back? Okay, so these are the environment, classic environments. So as you can see, this is the cart pole. So you have a cart and a vertical pole. So this is the environment described by Dr. Sutton in his book, and they have coded it here. So what action you can take is you can move the cart to left or right, and the aim is that pole should be stand vertical. At any point of time, if that pole tilts more than some angle, it is bound to fall and episode will end. So and then there are few environment parameters like wind velocity and the angle of the pole from the vertical line. Those are the parameters what you will get. So we'll see more in the later slide. Likewise, there is a mountain car where you have to reach at the top, and the action you can have is move the car in different directions. There are some text-based environments. So this is the grid environment, 4x4 grid. There is a start state, there is an end state, and there are some of states where H means there is a hole and you will fall and the episode will end. The target is to start from a start state and reach to the goal state. That's when the episode will successfully end. For each steps taken, you will get reward 1, and when you reach the goal state, the episode will end with a success. There are some Atari environments in the last session you saw, and all these environments you can code against, develop against, and so that's what you get when you go with this gym library. Okay, so whoever has laptop and want to start, let's clone this repository. It's my repository. What I have there is a template code. So you don't have to write entire code. That's not feasible in 90 minutes. So I have developed the template codes, and what you will write is just the important pieces of the equations, okay? So clone that, and there is a requirements.txt where it specifies the dependencies you need. There are not much dependencies. So let me show you quickly. So for multi-arm bandits, the multi-arm bandits environments are not included in the gym. So there are separately defined environments. So there is a Git repository link there. So you have to clone it and just install it. Okay. So second one is also needed. Both are needed. So if you have a Windows 64 machine, I have a pen drive there. You can copy it from there. You don't need to install your environments. But for other operating systems, okay. Is it visible now? Visible now? Yeah, it's a github.com/Saurabh1Deshpande, my first name and last name, /odsc-2018.git. There is one more pen drive I have if you want. So there are already two Can you please pass? Yeah, you can just pass back. Yeah, from pen drive, don't copy and everything. It's bit too heavy. It's 8 GB. Not everything is required. There are installers also there for Anaconda if you want it. But just if you have Windows 64, just copy the Anaconda 3 folder that is for Windows 64 and the repository. Okay. Yes. So. So if you are done with the pen drive, can you please pass it in front? Yeah, I have three. I have given all. Yeah, so internet is not there. So you can use your phone internet if you want to install or use. APIs. Yeah, so it will come to you, just wait. So people are just copying it. If you want to see all the environments in the OpenAI, what all environments are supported, first you need to import ENVs, so that is the class from Gym. And then you can print, there is a registry object, and you can print all the environments. Otherwise, you can always refer to the Gym wiki, or there is a page like this for most of the environments where the environments are described. So what they describe is the what that environment is, how that environment give out the reward, and what does it mean by solving this environment, okay? So in this case, cart pull one, if you get a average reward of 195 over 100 consecutive trials, then you can say that your algorithm has solved this environment. And you can also post your scores here, and that's how you can compare your algorithm with the one which has already been developed. No. So you start an environment. Okay. So there is a then what is the environment? You have a cart pole and a vertical bar. Your cart and a vertical pole. When you start an environment, it will give you some state that in which state that pole is, and you will move the cart either to the left or right. Okay, and depending upon your action, the port will tilt to either ways. If it tilts more than some angle, it will fall down and episode will end. Okay, the more for more time steps you survive, you keep the pole vertical, the more will be your rewards. Okay, you will not get it in one episode, right? In one trial, you have to do multiple trials, accumulate your rewards, learn the environment, okay, via some algorithm, and then this accumulation of the rewards over the trials goes above 195, 400 consecutive trials, you can say that your algorithm has solved this cart pole. Okay. So everybody has installed or copied? No? So any? No. This is for your reference. So that is from the Gym code, what the environment looks like. Okay. So there are four parameters in this environment. What is the cart position and the cart velocity, the pole angle and the pole velocity at the tip. So all these four parameters will affect your position of the pole, and when you move the cart, you can either push the cart to the left or right. These are the two actions you can take in this environment. That is your action space. Okay, and depending upon your action, the pole will tilt. If pole tilts more than, say, I think some 12 degrees or something, it will fail and that episode will end. Okay. That is one episode. So now our goal here is to somehow figure it out, the action and the which will result in the parameters so that, you know, pole stands vertical. Yes.
Anyone with an extra pen drive?
Okay. Before going to the this cart pole environment, what we will do is we will just try to code a very simple loop where we will initialize the environment, we will take a random action and we will render it. Okay, so that you will get an idea how you can do the basic loop for the agent. Start with the a basic start with basic agent loop.py in the assignments folder. There is no code in it, but you will write a basic simple loop in the main class. And what you will write is, this is the pseudo code and corresponding gym APIs. Okay. So what we are going to do is, we'll import the gym and we will start the cart pole environment. We will loop over for some number. We will do some number of episodes. When you start any episode, how do you start it? You have to reset that, you have to call the reset function so that new episode is started. Okay. And then once the episode is started, we will go and in a loop, we'll take the action left or right. And once the episode is finished, there is a point where the pole will tilt by some angle and episode will finish. And then you will break it out and then we'll do some print. So you need to save total number of steps you have taken and for all the episodes and the number of episodes. That will give us some number, how many number of average number of steps we took across the episodes. Okay, so on the right hand side, for your help, I have given the APIs. So how do you import gym? Import gym is the call. Then you have to create an environment. You have to do a mech call and the name of the environment. Name of the environment, you can get it from the environment page, exact name. To start the episode. It's a dot reset. So you have to create a session of that environment, right? Cartpole v0 or whatever is there. So we will use Cartpole environment and name. So I will tell you the name. So you have to pass a string like this, Cartpole-v1. So that is the name. So v1 represent the version. So if they change something in the environment, they version it using this v0 v1 thing. So right now, for this, what we'll do is we'll take a random action. We don't want, so the purpose is to just get familiar with the loop agent loop. So environment dot action space is what will give you all the actions. In this case, there are two actions, and dot sample will give you a random action out of it. So we'll just use that random action, and then how do you take the action on the environment, there is a step function and just pass that action to it. And if you want to render the cart pole, how it is behaving, the actual visualization, you have to call dot render. And when you are done with all the loop, just make a dot close call on the environment so that it will close down. Right. Yeah. So those are the numbers I have shown. So these are the parameters, the position of the cart, the velocity, pole angle, and the velocity at the tip. So these are the things which describe this environment, and this will decide the position of the pole. Sorry. Yeah, so I will show you what it returns in favor. It is a part of that return, not the only thing it returns. Yeah. So right now it will change, but for now just choose the random action. So the purpose is just to get familiar with the loop and the structure. Yeah, so I will, let me show you the what it returns actually. So it returns these four numbers. So it returns these four numbers, new state, which are those four parameters, reward, done. If it is done, it will be true. Done will be true. And info is just the additional information for debugging or other purpose, okay? Sorry. So that is the environment. So if you install Gym, that's what it gives you, okay? So this is what you will get when you take an action. With dot step, you take an action, and you get these four things as a return, and which you can use it further. Yes. change it to take a more with a more intelligent or different way. So in the next one, we will change it using random state or hill climb kind of algorithm. So we will change that in the next part. Yes, yes. And dot action space is all the actions, two in this case, and dot sample is the random one. Okay, so here is how you one way to do it. The first, you import the gym, then you can mech. So mech is the call where you initialize the environment. We will record total number of steps here, and we will run it for say 50 episodes, and then we'll loop over the number of episodes. Now first thing we need to do is reset that episode. So we'll do the reset call. So is the font visible at the back? Now? Okay. Let me try. Not sure if we can do this in Spider. Okay, so then we'll loop it until the episode is done. So how do we know episode is done? See this. So we get this action, which is a random action for now. Then we take that action on the environment, and which returns the new state. So do you remember that diagram? So you agent takes an action on environment. What it returns is new state and reward. So here it is. So new state, reward, and the episode is done. If the poll is fallen, then it will be true. And the info is just a debugging or other information. Threshold is defined by the environment, and environment is provided by the gym. That's where the standardization comes. Because if I code it for this environment, I will say some different number where the poll falls, you will say some different number, and our results, we cannot compare, right? No, you, there is a way to create a custom environment and register it, but you cannot change the, yeah, of course it is open source, you can go and change, but that's not the point. Okay, so the render will actually render in visualization of the card, and when done is true, we will just append the steps, how many steps we have taken, and we'll break it out. And the last call is close. Let me run it so that you will see how it works. So here it is showing, and so when it falls, it starts over, and you can see that, you know, poll is going the way around, and the action it is, sorry, action being taken. Okay. Yeah, so it's just you do interpretation. Okay. So this is the basic structure in which you can work, and you can implement different strategies for selecting the actions and, maximize the reward and those kind of things. No, it's no. So in the assignment part, you have to code it, and there is in the code part, there is already coded example is there. So if you don't want to code or just want to run it, you can select from there. Okay. The file name is a basic agent loop. Okay. So in the interest of time, let's go to the next one. Next one, you don't have to code everything. There is a template code available. So now, what we did in the basic agent loop is we selected the action randomly, which is not very good or not very efficient. Now, what we will do is we will apply two simple strategies to select an action so that we get a better reward, or we get a better cumulative reward over our number of episodes. So, first one is the random search approach. So, instead of randomly selecting the action, what we will do is the parameters which we are getting back from the environment, we will apply some random weight. So in somehow, what you need to do is the parameters you are getting back from the environment, you have to convert them to an action, right? So depending upon the parameters, somehow you have to convert them to action. So the first simple strategy, what we will do is we will have four random numbers, which are mapping to the four observations written by the environment. We will take a dot product of it, and if that dot product is say greater than zero, we will go to the right, or if it is less than zero, we'll go to the left. So the weights what we are going to choose for converting this observations to the action, we will choose randomly. Okay, that's why it is called as a random search. And in this diagram, what it depicts is you get the random weights, and there will be a weight which gives us the maximized reward, and that is what we will choose. So that's what we will do in this random search. So yes. Yes. So over the period of time, next state, I. Yes. So, no. No. So, the cartpole environment, if you take an action, it gives back you four numbers, right? Now, what I will do is I will randomly choose four numbers as weights. I will do a dot product. Okay, when you will do a dot product, you get a single number, right? And if that number is less than zero, I will move the card to the left. If that number is greater than one, I will say move the card to the right. For episode, one episode, next episode. So I will show you the quickly the code so you will understand that loop. Okay, so it's the same kind of structure. You make an environment, you create the environment, there are episodes. There are more things we are trying to record, like best reward and the best parameters. And then we'll run it for a number of episodes. Now, in this function, run episode function. So this function will run one episode. We'll first reset it, and when I'm calling this run episode, I'm passing the parameters, okay? And how I'm selecting the parameters, I'm selecting it randomly, okay? So for that episode, those will be my parameters, and those are the weights basically. And what I will do is, in the episode, every time, those will be fixed for that episode, and I will do a dot product of the observations I'm getting from the environment each time and the parameters, and I will select the action accordingly, okay? Now, what you have to do here is implement this random search, which is nothing but you have to return the random array of four numbers which are between minus 1 and 1, okay? And we will improve it little bit in the next hill climb, where you will add some noise cancellation so that you improve that randomness bit by bit. Which one? No, that should be minus 1 to 1, because the observation which is coming is in that range. Yes. So there is a, if you are aware of NumPy, there is a random package in that which we can use. So yes, but random action is completely random. You select it randomly, but here at least the weights are random, and we are mapping that to the parameters you are actually getting from the environment, and on that you are selecting an action. So the observations you get, ideally the observations you get from the environment, you have to map it to the action, right? So yes. Okay. So let's wait for 1 or 2 minutes if you want to try it out, or otherwise I will. Yes, so yes, there are ways you can also do the gradient descent. Distribution of what? Yes, so that is, I think, normal Gaussian from NumPy random. Yeah, I mean, you can try it out. Yes, that is the next part actually. Okay. Not very specific to this, but depending upon the environment, you can try it out which works for best for that environment. Okay, so this is how you can generate the random weights with a okay. So hill climbing it's little bit improvement over the randomly choosing parameters. You add a bit of a noise multiplier, and with that you return the functions. With that you choose the parameters. So instead of just randomly choosing the parameters, you apply this noise factor, and if the reward which you are getting is better, then you keep those parameters and you start with that. So right now we are just discarding the old parameters, right? But here in this case, we are preserving the parameters which we are getting the better rewards, and then. So only the difference is you use this noise cancelling parameter along with the random numbers to return the weights, and rest of the things are same. We'll do the dot product and choose the action. No, so noise is just a way to reduce the randomness of the weights we are choosing. So instead of just completely random parameters, we use this noise to go bit by bit towards the optimal. Okay, so I will give a couple of more minutes if you want to try it out. So you can also check the code in the code section if you want to get an idea. So for gradient descent, you are talking about? Yeah, so maybe we can take that offline because it is a different approach than this. Which one? Gym is just the environment and the depending upon the action, it gives the reward. So how it decides what rewards to give, I think it depends on environment to environment. So tweak the gym implementations of the environment, you want to see? You can register your custom environments in the gym and use it. So to use Adam or any other optimizer, you have to do the gradient descent and those sort of structures, right? To create, basically calculate the loss and do the calculation based on the loss, right? So can you elaborate your question maybe? So reward is what is returned by the environment, which we don't know fully what is the how the rewards are going to get for the action. That's where you need to explore the action and learn the distribution of the reward. So basically that is the action value distribution. So when you keep on doing this over the period of time, say suppose you keep on taking the actions which either gives you better rewards in near time or the long time, it converges to the policy which is optimum over the period of time with multiple actions or multiple episodes. So which algorithm? So see, reinforcement learning is a structure or the way the problem is defined. There is no particular algorithm called reinforcement learning. So it's a agent-based learning where you create these kind of strategies to maximize the rewards. Maybe we can take it offline if you want to. Okay, so the next learning problem is multi-arm bandits. So as we have also seen in the previous section, these are basically called multi-arm bandits because of the there is a slot machine and you have arm and you pull the arm and you get the reward, and instead of one arm you have multiple arms, and multiple arms can give you each arm can give you different rewards, and it has different distribution of the rewards which you don't know, and the objective is to given this kind of multi-armed bandits environment, we want to maximize our rewards over the period of time. So just to put it more formally in the mathematical equation, at any point, any time t, if you take an action A, the expected reward is Q star A, and that is the expected reward, and when you run your episodes, what you get is the QTA is the value of any action at given point of time. So we want to, we would like to have the Q at time t for action A as close as possible for the Q star A. So now when we deal with this multi-arm bandit, we have multiple actions to choose from. So each arm is one action. So you can choose first arm and get some reward. You have second arm, you'll get some reward. And then as we saw, you can just keep on pulling the arm which is giving you some reward, that will be called as exploitation, because we know what reward it gives, and there will be always some arms which we have not tried which also might give us the better reward. So that is the exploration part of it. So we have to balance between this exploitation and exploration. So that is the dilemma we have, and the reward which we are going to get over the period of time, we have to formalize it in some way so that we have a record of those rewards. So one way is to have the average rewards we got over the period of time for a given arm. So how you can calculate it is, the sum of rewards you have got for that arm and the number of times that arm has been taken or that action has been taken. So that is the average reward per arm. And now when you want, there is a time to select the action, the simplest thing you can do is whoever has given you the maximum reward till date, you can select that action, select that arm. So that will be the greedy part of it. So you know that out of say 10, this third one has given me the average reward, maximum average reward so far. So you can keep on doing the 3. But in a while, you should also try to explore what other arms are giving. That way, we can maximize the accumulated reward over the time. Each arm is an action, so you have to select it and you will get a reward. So agent is what it will select the arm and it will try to maximize the reward. So if agent knows that, agent will have the information, it will calculate the average reward per arm and it will keep on selecting it if it wants to do greedily or if it wants to explore the other arms, it will go and select that action. Sorry. Yes. So average, so how we are calculating, so suppose you have 5 arms, okay? So initially you need to start randomly and you will know that first, if you pull the first reward, it gives such and such, if you pull the first, take the first action or select the first arm, you will get some reward, second, third, and you will store them like this. So for each arm, what is the mean reward you have got? What will be that? The sum of the rewards over the period of time you have got and number of time divided by number of time that arm is selected, right? And when next time you're going to choose the action, what is the simplest way of doing it? See the max of it. So which arm has given you the maximum mean reward and select it. So that's the greedy part of it. That is from our previous knowledge. But if you keep on doing this, you will get the same maximum reward, but it is also possible that other arms are giving more rewards. So you have to choose them at some point of time and you have to balance between these two. Yeah, but you don't know what other arms are giving you, right? It might be better than this. So no, for this bandits, this is what you have. So the state is you choose the arm and what reward you got, that is what the state. So yeah, so each arm, what rewards it returns has some probability distribution which you don't know. Yeah, but that's, you need to choose the action, right? You can go for that arm always, or you can. So somebody was trying to say something. Okay. Now, how do you balance between you want to exploit your knowledge, exploitation or exploration? So what you can do is you can have a parameter, say, depending on which you can either choose sometime exploration. So sometimes you choose the arms which you haven't explored and most of the times you choose from what you have. So maximum rewards, what you have. That way, what will happen is you will also explore your environment, and you can also take an advantage of the earlier knowledge of what we have, the average reward we have stored per arm. Okay, so these kind of action selection strategies are called e-greedy action selection. So epsilon greedy. So epsilon is a parameter you can set. Say for example, I say that 0.5, and then what I will do is I will randomly generate a number. So randomly generate a number from 0 to 1, and I will compare that with a 0.5. So say that what will happen because of that, for half of the time, I will exploit my knowledge of the actually learned environment or the arms, the rewards, and for rest of the times, I will go and take the choose the arms which I haven't chosen. So that way, this parameter will control the exploration versus exploitation we want to do. Okay, so you can change the epsilon and try. Let's see the how can you get the rewards. The epsilon is set, and you can try out with different epsilon values and how the rewards, what total rewards you are getting over the period. Okay, so so this is the template for multi-arm bandit. So what we are doing is here, so we are calculating the mean reward per bandit or per arm, and we are remembering that. And so when we select an action, what we do is so we set this epsilon for our experiment, and we generate a random number, and if that random number is less than the epsilon, we will select the random action, or otherwise we will select the action depending upon the average rewards per arm what we are explored so far. Okay, so that way this epsilon parameter will control the exploration versus exploitation. So, and similarly, so there is another way of choosing this action, which is called as upper confidence bound. So it is a different equation. So here what we are doing is we are adding one more parameter, which is kind of controls the square root term you have is on the top. You have the time step, the logarithm, the time step. So at what time? So if it is the 15th time step, that will be the logarithm of 15. And the denominator is number of time that action is taken. What happens because of this is, say if I'm taking an action which is already been taken, that the numerator is going to increase because it's the next time step, but the denominator remains the same because we have already explored that action. And because we are calculating our action depending upon this kind of calculation, it sets the upper bound with which you can do the exploration or exploitation. So we can compare this with eGreedy, and let's see what happens. So what I will do is I will run the program, I will run the code which has implemented both of these actions in one way, and we will plot it on the one graph. So before that, I will quickly show you how you can implement this equation in the given in the slides. So this is the implementation of that equation. We have already recorded the mean rewards per bandit, and this is the parameter we have set, and then you can return the maximum, the arm giving you the maximum reward by this equation. So in a loop, you can update this state and action table continuously with this equation, and choose the action depending on that. So let's try to run. So there are 1,000 episodes I have taken, and for each episode, around 850 times, we will do the iteration to get the average rewards. So you can see that. So the blue one is using upper confidence bound, and the red one is using eGreedy strategy. So initially the eGreedy, so the plot is for the average rewards, what we have got over the period of time for these episodes. And you can see that for eGreedy, it is faring better initially, but the UCB kind of strategy takes over after some episodes, and then it gives you the better rewards over the period of time. Okay. Yeah. So the numerator is time step, denominator is number of times that action is selected. So, and the parameter C is controls that degree of again exploration versus exploitation, but this time it gives more emphasis on the actions depending upon the what actions you have previously selected. So in the past implementation, we are just randomly selecting an action, right? If the epsilon parameter is less than what we have set for, you are randomly selecting from the environment, or we are selecting from what we have in our memory for this action, what the mean reward is. But here the bit improvement is, instead of randomly selecting from the environment, we are just trying to see what actions has a more probability or more possibility of giving you the better rewards. Instead of just selecting randomly. So in this case, when there is a time to choose the actions randomly, we just choose it randomly without even bothering which action has a more potential of giving us the better rewards. Yeah, so if you go in the literature, if you see the derivation of the equation, there are things, I mean, because of that, there is a, it fares better than the e-greedy in the long run, okay? Okay, fine, just to now close off, what we'll see is the demo of deep Q learning. So there is an environment called as Pong, Atari Pong game, and let's run the Pong game without any intelligence by selecting the action. We'll get an idea what the environment is. So this is the game, and when right hand side is our agent and the left hand side is the environment. So whenever there is a miss in the when the ball is missed by that bat, other part gets the reward. So right now it is not doing much, or our reward is kind of zero. Yes, this was the random. Now I will run the code which is trained using deep Q learning network, and let's see how it fares against. So this model is already pre-trained, and I'm using that model for running the game. Yeah, I mean, so that randomness is, I think, by the factor C in the formula. Yeah, but you can change it and see. Yeah, but at some point of time, because there is a randomness in the formula, you will end up in exploring the other action. It's not like it will always give you the same action. It's just that, so in e-greedy, what you did is randomly selected the actions. Here, what we are trying to do is at least trying to select an action which might give us the reward in the long term, instead of just randomly selecting it. So even if this is in that case, in some cases, the second action will get selected and it will get into the, it will become a greedy action. Yes, so it depends on the domain and the environment. So before applying this, this is just for what the gym environments gives. Okay, so thank you. Thank you very much for attending the workshop. If you have any questions, if you need any help with the code, please contact me. I'm on LinkedIn and you can get connected with me. And you have the repository with you. You can go and clone it and play with it. Thank you.